بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما، أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم، وأنم علينا يا عظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and peace be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah Almighty, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, tonight is another night with one of the great prophets and messengers, and one of the greatest of mankind. Tonight we continue with the story of the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, in which his story shall be finished by tonight, to start a story of another great prophet and messenger. And last week we spoke about Musa alayhi salam and Bani Israel, and we spoke about how Musa alayhi salam suffered a lot from Bani Israel and faced a lot of the hardships. Faced a lot of hardships with Bani Israel, much more hardships that he faced from Fir'aun, which Bani Israel, they're his own people, his own followers. Fir'aun was his enemy. But these followers, his own people, were much more arrogant. They were much more of a hardship than Fir'aun, his own enemy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He blessed Bani Israel to see miracles take place with their own eyes that probably no other nation had ever experienced what they've experienced. No other nation had seen what they've seen. And over all the amazing things, over all the miracles they've seen with their own eyes, heard with their own ears, experienced and touched with their own hands, over all that, this did not even make them more of stronger believers and stronger followers to Musa alayhi salam. And last week we spoke about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised Bani Israel the sacred land of Jerusalem, Ilya. And Allah azza wa jal ordered Bani Israel to enter Ilya, Jerusalem, and victory will be granted to them. And Bani Israel, after they've seen the miracles take place on the hands of their prophet and messenger, Musa alayhi salam, they weren't encouraged one single bit to enter Ilya. And then they responded in an arrogant and a rude manner to Musa alayhi salam, saying to him, اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إنها هنا قاعدون. Oh Musa, go you and your Lord and fight. We are sitting here. We're not going to go anywhere. We're never going to enter this place unless these people walk out of it. As long as they're in there, we're not going to walk out. We're not going to walk in until the people walk out, then we'll walk in. See the arrogance, the rudeness. And because of that, Musa made dua on them. He said, Ya Allah, إِنِّي لَا أَمْلِكُ إِلَّا نَفْسِي وَأَخِي. Ya Allah, as you know, and as you've seen, and as you've heard, I have no one with me except myself and my brother. This whole nation, from the thousands of them, from the best and the worst one out of all of them, will refuse to follow me and obey me. I have no one except me and myself and my brother. فَفْرُقْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Ya Allah, distinguish between us, me and my brother who obey you and follow your orders, and those who disobey you, Allah. Don't put us in the same category. Don't punish us. فَفْرُقْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Ya Allah, do not put us in the same basket as them and punish us as them. We don't deserve that. We are obedient to you. For that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal, He punished Bani Israel. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a punishment on Bani Israel, a punishment called عذاب التي. And عذاب التي is the punishment of being lost. They were lost for 40 years. What's that punishment? They were lost for 40 years. They can't find a place to live in. They can't find a city or a town to stay in. Even though some of them know that there is a city or a town there, they just go and walk and walk and travel for long, a long and long, long period, and they can't even find the place. Allah made them lost in the desert, that's it. Wherever they go, they can't find a land to live in. They can't find a city to stay in. They can't find a town to settle in. For 40 years, ikhwan. Punishment from Allah. Because Allah Azza wa Jal had given you the best of land and you refused. Just to obey Allah, walk in and fight for the sake of Allah. When Allah had guaranteed victory to you. And now, you want something? This is your punishment. For 40 years, they were lost on land. In that 40 years, my brothers and sisters, and we mentioned that last week and in brief, they did not have food, so Allah gave them food. He gave them manu salwa. They did not have water. Allah ordered Musa to hit a stone with his stick. And that stone exploded 12. Exploded 12 springs. For each tribe, one spring to drink from. And each time they used to travel, they will carry that rock or stone, and that stone will stop floating water or flowing water. And then they continue traveling. And when they put that stone, then that stone will continue to flow water. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sheltered them during the day with clouds. Wherever they are, this cloud comes and shades them from the sun. Rahma min Rabbil Alameen. In that 40 years, my brothers and sisters, in that lost, in Nati for 40 years, Bani Israel is living in nowhere. They were like Bedouins, nomads. They have no land or they have no town or city to live in. They were just living in the desert. And it's not easy to live in the desert. There's a lot of things that mankind need to consume. And those consumptions, you only get them from the land, the city or the towns. For 40 years, my brothers, that were lost. As a punishment for the refusal of following the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Prophet and Messenger Musa. In the tea, two major incidents that we know of took place. In the tea, two major events took place that we know of. Maybe there's a lot more than that that took place in that 40 years, but we don't know of. From those two being mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem is the story of the cow and the story of Musa and the Khidr. And this is inshallah what we'll talk about tonight. The story of the cow. And a full surah, the biggest surah in the Quran al-Kareem, is named after the incident, Al-Baqarah, the cow. One day, when Bani Israel was sleeping in the middle of the desert, one of the strong and influential leaders was assassinated at night. They slept that night. Before they slept, he was alive. After they woke up, he was dead, killed. Now this is one of their leaders. He's one of their men. He's one of their great influential leaders. He was killed. They're not going to let this just go like that. Who killed him? So they wanted to investigate. Who killed him? Who was where at this time? Who was at that time? That investigation took place. So one of them said, why should you bother? Why should you bother going through all these hardships into looking who killed him when you have a prophet that he claims he speaks to his Lord? Just go and ask him. With full disrespect, my brothers and sisters, not wallah, we have a prophet. We have a prophet, and this prophet is someone that communicates with Allah. And this someone is great that we should respect. No, it wasn't like this to Bani Israel. Musa alayhi salam was disrespected. But because of what Allah Azza wa Jal had shown Bani Israel from the miracles they used to see Musa alayhi salam. Like when Allah Azza wa Jal ordered them through Musa alayhi salam to follow and take the commandments, they refused and refused and refused. And Allah Azza wa Jal took a mountain, that this mountain went at the top of their heads, and that mountain spoke to them and said, take what Allah Azza wa Jal had ordained you. That's when they get scared. So they said, yes, it's true. This guy, we've seen some miracles take place. He probably knows he killed him. He probably knows he killed him. So let's go and ask him. Maybe he'll ask his Lord. Not our Lord. Maybe he'll ask his Lord. Okay? And he'll tell us who killed our leader. So we could retaliate for him. So they went to Musa alayhi salam. And they told him, oh Musa, you're a prophet, you're a messenger. You say you speak to Allah and you say you speak to the Lord of this universe. Then show us some of your miracles. And one of those miracles that we really want to see today is tell your Lord and ask him who killed our leader. So Musa alayhi salam went and asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah azza wa jalla wanted to put them through the test. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Musa, tell them to slaughter a cow. Tell them to slaughter a cow. And then when they slaughter that cow, tell them to grab a portion or a part of that cow, hit the dead, and then you'll see what happens. So Musa alayhi salam, after he spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he came to Bani Israel and he said that Allah azza wa jal orders you to slaughter a cow. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَذْبَحُوا بَقَرَةً. Allah orders you to slaughter a cow. So what did Bani Israel respond back to Musa? قَالُوا أَتَتَّخِذُنَا هُزُوًا. You're making fun of us? What, are you joking? You're a prophet, you're a messenger, you're a messenger. You're making fun of him, are you joking around with us? What's this got to do with slaughtering a cow? Slaughtering a cow, what's that got to do with killing someone and someone to find out who killed or who's the murderer, who's the assassiner? We're telling you one of our leaders got killed and assassinated and you're telling us go and slaughter a cow? You making fun of us or something? Who are you speaking to? Musa alayhi salam, this is a prophet. He's going to go and make fun of the deen? Wal'ayyadu billah. We are, our iman, Allahu alam, how far it is from the iman of Musa alayhi salam, would not even dare to make something like that. Someone with little iman, he does not even dare to make fun or make jokes of Islam. Musa, a prophet, a messenger, one of the greatest ones. They're accusing him of making jokes and fun of Islam. So they said, أَتَتَّخِذُنَا هُزُوَا. So Musa was shocked. He said, قَالَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect me. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant me protection. And أَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ. I ask Allah to protect me from being from the ignorant ones. Me? Muck around? In religion of Islam, a'udhu billah, it doesn't even suit a prophet and a messenger to muck around in the dunya, to muck around for the deen. So they said, okay, it looks like you're serious. قالوا, ادعو لنا ربك يبين لنا ما هي. Okay, since your Lord wants us to slaughter a cow, we'll slaughter a cow. What kind of a cow is it? So Musa said, Allah said slaughter a cow, so just go and slaughter any cow. From the cows, there's many of them here in front of you, go and slaughter any. Doesn't matter. How big, how old, how fat, how skinny. Just slaughter any cow. They said, no, that doesn't make sense. You know, you're talking about something serious. You have to be more serious. It doesn't make any sense that slaughter any cow. And Musa said, just go slaughter any cow. There's no need for you to make it hard on yourself. So they said, no, it doesn't make sense to us. So Musa alayhi salam went to Allah. And he said, oh Allah, what kind of a cow is it? So they became hard, and Allah became harder on them. They became strict, and Allah Azza wa Jal made it strict on them. So Allah Azza wa Jal said, قَالَ إِنَّهُ يَقُولُ إِنَّهَا بَقَرَةٌ لَا فَارِضٌ وَلَا بِكْرٌ عَوَانٌ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ. Okay, you refuse to slaughter any cow. Now Allah Azza wa Jal is saying to you, it's a cow that's neither a calf nor a mature. So it's not too old, not too young. Something in the middle. Something in the middle. Not a cow that's too old, nearly to die. Not a cow that's just nearly born. Something normal. A teenage cow, if you want to call it. Just go and slaughter it. Okay, from Allahu Alam, the thousands of cows they had, now there's probably 500 of them in the same. So they said, okay, this is not enough of a description. We've got a lot of cows that are like this. We've got a lot of cows that average size and average age. So tell your Lord and ask him what color is it. Musa said, any color, just go and slaughter it. They said, no, that's not enough. قال ادع لنا ربك يبين لنا ما لونها. Ask your Lord to tell us what color is it. So they became hard again. So Allah Azza wa Jalla became more hard on them. قال إنه يقول إنها بقرة صفراء فاقع لونها تسر الناظرين. Before we told you slaughter any cow, you refused. So now it became in a certain age. Now it's in a certain color. Allah Azza wa Jalla saying to you, it's a yellowish cow. A yellowish cow. A yellowish cow. A yellow color cow. So yellow. It's not mixed with no other color. فاقع اللون. So bright in its color. يعني not in yellow, but a bright yellow. تسر الناظرين. That it attracts the sight of people when they see it. It attracts the sight of people when they see it. Yeah, and look for that now. Yani now, from being any cow into being a certain age cow and a certain color cow. And now the color of it, a yellowish cow, so yellow that it's so bright. تسر الناظرين, attracts the sights. When it walks, everyone, this is a different color cow. So when Musa alayhi salam said that, again they asked, قال ادعو لنا ربك يبين لنا ما هي إن البقرة تشابه علينا وإن إن شاء الله لمهتدون. This is not enough of a description. We need more. We looked around and we found these few cows in the same description. But we wanted a specific cow. And Musa said, just go and slaughter it. Why are you making it hard on yourself? Allah's making it easy on you. Make it easy on yourself. Don't make it hard, or else Allah will make it hard on you. So he went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Musa alayhi salam, and he asked Allah for more description. So they became so hard on themselves. Allah became very hard on them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded back to him. قال ادع لنا ربك يبين لنا ما هي إن البقرة تشابه علينا وإن إن شاء الله لمهتدون. قال إنه يقول إنها بقرة لا ذلول تثير الأرض ولا تسقي الحرث مسلمة لا شية فيها. Now it's a very rare and hard type of a cow to get. He said, Allah Azza is saying, now this cow that you're after, it's not too old, it's not too young. It's a car, a cow. What do I keep on saying car? Because we're used to cars, huh? It's a cow that's a very bright yellow. And it's a cow that never worked in its life. It's not used for any labor work. Walks on land untouched. Like a cow with dignity and respect. Never worked before. Not used for any labor work. Not used for any work. Not used for any hardships. مُسَلَّمَةٌ لَا شِيَةَ فِيهَا. Bright yellow that it's not mixed with any other color. Now, from many cows, from the many cows they had of an option to a very rare type of a cow. So they went now and they said, الآن جئت بالحق. Now we are satisfied to go and look for this cow. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us not to make the deen hard on us when deen is easy. Not to complicate it when it's easy and it's so smooth. And this is how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. And Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam said, إِنَّ هَذَا الدِّينَ مَتِينَ. This deen is strong and firm. So do not become too hard in it. It's a firm deen. It's a strong deen. It's a straight deen. There's no need for you to make it harder or for you to complicate it. It's an easy path. So they went to look for that cow. And went around and looking for that cow. And looking for that cow. Until they found it being owned to one young man. And that young man heard of the news that Bani Israel, or a lot of people from Bani Israel, are looking for a certain described cow, and he's the only one that he had. So when they came to him, for him to sell it to them, he said, I'll sell it to you with its weight gold. I'll sell it to you with its weight gold. And it's not even properly worth 1% of that. It's not even properly worth 1% of that. But because they became hard, Allah Azza wa Jal made it hard on them. They made it strict on themselves, so Allah Azza wa Jal made it strict on them. And this is the type of nation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him strict laws and rules. And then they bought that cow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَذَبَحُوهَا وَمَا كَادُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. Even after they did buy that cow and slaughter it, they did it and they weren't even convinced. It's like, you know, we're doing it just for the sake of it. Not doing it because this is an order from Allah Azza wa Jal. Not doing it because I believe Allah ordered me to do this, so I do it because Allah did order me to do it. They did it and they didn't want to do it. But they just did it for the sake of it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِذْ قَتَلْتُمْ نَفْسًا فَادَّارَأْتُمْ فِيهَا وَاللَّهُ مُخْرِجٌ مَا كُنْتُمْ تَكْتُمُونَ. And you've killed one person from among you, and if you and each one of you hid and hided away, the one that killed, who was hiding between you, and none of you knew who he was. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took out the secret that was hidden between you. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla said, فَقُلْنَا اضْرِبُوهُ بِبَعْضِهَا. Hit your dead, that leader of yours that has been assassinated and killed, after you slaughter that cow, grab a portion of that meat of that cow and hit your dead, and you'll see what will happen in front of you. So they did that. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, كَذَلِكَ يُحْيِي اللَّهُ الْمَوْتَى وَيُرِيكُمْ آيَاتِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. After they slaughtered the cow and grabbed the thigh to hit the dead, the person who was killed, they hit him and they know he was dead in front of them. That dead became alive in front of all of them. And he said, this person killed me and went back dead. In front of all of them, ikhwani. It didn't take place in front of 2-3 people. Bani Israel, with its numbers and its people, they gathered around in that scene. And they saw the whole scene. The dead came back alive, speaking out, saying, who killed him and went back dead again? I say to you, my brother, I say to you, my sister, could you imagine if you were there? Could you imagine when you see someone who's dead, in front of you dead, comes back alive and then goes back dead? What would you do? I'll tell you what you'd do. You'll be in this corner here 24 hours. You'll be in the corner of the mosque 24 hours. You saw a miracle. What kind of a miracle is that? An amazing miracle. Something that mankind's mind can't handle. The dead came back alive and he spoke. And he said, this person killed me, and he went back dead. Ya ikhwan, did that soften the hearts of Bani Israel? Did that make the people of Bani Israel say to Musa, oh Musa, we surrender to your Lord. We surrender to your orders. We follow you and we're willing to do anything. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, ثُمَّ قَصَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ. Then your heart became even more harder than what it used to be. After everything you've seen and after everything you've experienced, your heart became more harder than what it used to be. And Allah Azza wa says, فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ أَشَدُّ قَصْوَى. Your heart became even more harder than the rocks and stones, and even more harder than that. وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْحِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَتَفَجَّرُ مِنُ الْأَنْهَارَ. And Allah says, some of the rocks explode and soften up from the streaming of the river. And some, وَإِنَّ مِنْهَ لَمَا يَشَّقَّقُ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءُ. And some of it will break down from the water. Water will break it down. But your heart's miracles can't even break it down. وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَهْبِطُ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. And some of it will shake. Some of it will crack from the feet of Allah. These are rocks, mountains. لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. If this Quran was to be revealed on a mountain, you see the mountain shake, humble from the fear of Allah. Your heart, after everything you've seen, and after everything you experienced, your heart is just becoming harder and harder, becoming more solid and solid, more fearless and more fearless. What's wrong with you people? This is the type of Bani Israel. This is the incident of the Baqarah. The event of Baqarah that took place in the presence of Bani Israel. They saw it, they heard it, my brothers and sisters, and this did not soften their hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named the Surah Al-Baqarah, although the story of the Baqarah, the story of the cow, is only a few verses from the 255 verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. And Allah Azza wa Jalla named the whole surah after the event. The other event, my brothers and sisters in Islam, that took place during during that moment in which Bani Israel were lost, is Musa alayhi salam and the Khidr. Musa alayhi salam, one day, when he was around his people, around his nation, one of his followers, one of his people, he asked Musa and he said, "Oh Musa, who is the most knowledgeable person on earth?" So Musa alayhi salam, as a prophet, as a messenger, from his knowledge, from his experience, from looking around, he thought there is no one more knowledgeable than him. So he said, "Me. I am the most knowledgeable person on earth." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to teach his servant and slave and messenger a good lesson. Don't say something that you don't know. Don't answer something that you don't know. And how many of us, ikhwan, we have the guts to say and speak out what we don't know? And this is the prophet, a messenger. He spoke out something that he did not know of. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to teach him a good lesson. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he started to blame to Musa alayhi salam. And he told him, "Oh Musa, who told you you are the most knowledgeable person on earth? Where did you get this information from? Where's your resources? Where's your dalil? Where did you get this from?" So Musa alayhi salam, with full humbleness, he said, "Ya Allah, I did not think of anyone being more knowledgeable than me." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, "There is someone more knowledgeable than you. And that someone, you will meet him. That someone, you will see him and meet him where the two rivers meet. Where the two rivers meet." And Allah Azza wa Jal gave him a sign. That sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Musa alayhi salam, because where the two rivers meet is a populated area. Which one is he? Allah told him, "When you lose your lunch, when you lose your food, that's where you'll meet him." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا. When Musa alayhi salam told his servant, Fata means his kid, his child, and the scholars agree it was Yusha alayhi salam, and many of the scholars say Yusha is the son of Musa alayhi salam, others say he isn't, but this, that he was with Musa alayhi salam, this servant or this kid or this servant of Allah that was with Musa alayhi salam, accompanying him in this journey, his name was Yusha alayhi salam. And no doubt he was a prophet, and inshallah we'll talk about Yusha at the end of the story, because he is the one that led Bani Israel after the death of Musa. When Musa alayhi salam told his servant Yusha alayhi salam, "I would not stop and give up until I get to that place where the two rivers end. And where the two rivers end, it ends where the Red Sea, Egypt, between Egypt and Saudi Arabia, there's the Red Sea. The Red Sea ends with two long rivers. Those two long rivers meet in a corner at the bottom of Sina. That's where Musa alayhi salam was going to." And alayhi salam was walking and traveling and traveling. And Yusha realized it's taking long and it's taking long. So he asked him, "When is this going to end?" So Musa said, "It's not going to end until I go where the two rivers end. Even if I travel for years and decades." Huqab means a decade. "Even if I go for decades, 20, 30, 40 years, I'm going to get to that place." There's a knowledge there. There's knowledge. And Musa alayhi salam wants to go and seek this knowledge. He's willing to sacrifice all that for the sake of that knowledge. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا نَسِيَ حُوتَهُمَا فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ سَرَبًا. When they got to where the two rivers end, Musa alayhi salam was so exhausted. So he went and sat under a tree and slept. While Musa alayhi salam is sleeping, Yusha is awake. They had in their little basket fish to eat. Hoot is the fish. While they Yusha alayhi salam sitting, looking around, looking on to the sea, to the water that Allah created, the land around him. Musa alayhi salam is asleep. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the sign. That dead fish that's inside that basket, being cooked and grilled, ready to be eaten, came back alive, jumped out of the basket and went back into the sea. Who's saying that? Yusha. Allahu Akbar. What's happening here? Am I dreaming? Or this is reality? It's real. But he's not going to wake Musa. Musa is a prophet and a messenger. Your father, you have so much respect for him. You wouldn't wake him up only if there's something very important. So you say, I'll tell him later. Yusha had this respect for Musa alayhi salam. He didn't want to wake him up. So he left him asleep. And Musa alayhi salam was so tired, he slept. After Musa woke up, Yusha forgot to tell Musa. Musa got up and then he was looking. He's looking for this man that's more knowledgeable than him. So they continued their journey, looking around. While they're going around, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَا, after they passed where they were in, قَالَ لِفَتَاهُ, Musa told Yusha, اِئْتِنَا غَدَاءَنَا, we're hungry. It's been a long time that we haven't eaten. Where's that food that we cooked and grilled? Where's that nice fish? Let's sit down and eat. لَقَدْ لَقِينَا مِنْ سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَبًا, we got tired from this traveling. So Yusha said, Subhanallah, أرأيت إذ أوينا إلى الصخرة فإني نسيت الحوت. Remember when we sat down and you relaxed and you slept, something amazing took place there. When we sleep, this fish that was grilled and dead came back alive. وما أنسانيه إلا الشيطان أذكره. And the shaitan, no one but the shaitan made me forget to tell you. So Musa alayhi salam said, واتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا. And then continuing the verse, Yusha is saying, and the fish went inside the sea again and went freely again. Amazing. He said, عجبا, I was amazed. So Musa alayhi salam responded, قال ذلك ما كنا نب. This is exactly what we've been waiting for. This is the sign that Allah had given me. Once I lose my food, that's where I'll find that man who is more knowledgeable than me. And this shows you, ikhwani, the importance of seeking knowledge. And no matter how much you know, it doesn't mean you always know. And doesn't mean because you know, you don't need to seek knowledge. You would not know more than Musa. And your status in Allah, with Allah Azza is not higher than Musa. And Musa started to go and seek knowledge for someone that he doesn't even know. So Musa alayhi salam went back. فَارْتَدَّ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمَا قَصَصًا, and started to retrace their steps where they came back, where they came from, going back to the exact place to meet with that man that knows more than Musa. When they arrived there, what did Allah say? When they got there, فَوَجَدَا, they found, عَبْدًا مِّنْ عِبَادِنَا, a servant from our servants, آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِّنْ عِنْدِنَا, we had granted him mercy from us, وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِّنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا, and we had taught him the knowledge from our presence. We had taught him the knowledge from ours, a knowledge that not many people have. So they were shocked when they left that place, there was no one. Now they came back to the same place, they found someone from the servants of Allah, in which Allah Azza had granted mercy and knowledge to. Musa alayhi salam knew that's a man. قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمني مما علمت رشدا. Musa went up to him and said, can I follow you? Can I accompany you? Can I be with you? Would you allow me to be with you? Would you allow me to accompany you so I could learn from what Allah had given you? So I could learn this knowledge that Allah Azza wa Jalla had taught you? See the ikhwani, the respect a prophet and a messenger from the most knowledgeable creation of Allah is having this respect to a teacher to learn from him. So what did this righteous servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and who's that righteous servant? It's Khidr alayhi salam. The scholars agree it's Khidr alayhi salam. And Khidr, the scholars in disagreement, some say he's a wali, others say he's a prophet. Some say he's a wali, others say he's a prophet. But he was someone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave knowledge. And Allahu A'lam, from this verse you realize, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him a lot of things, Some of that's why the scholars say he was a prophet, because it was revealed to him. So when Musa alayhi salam asked permission from him, would you allow me to accompany you and be with you to learn from some of that knowledge that Allah had granted you? So the Khidr told him, قَالَ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعِي صَبْرًا. You can't handle being with me. It's not easy to accompany me. It's not easy to be with me. Why? Because I act upon things that you don't know. You might see it one way, but I know other things that you don't know. And we understand what I was just talking about now. So Musa alayhi salam, again, he insisted on him. I would love to learn from you. I want to learn. I want to know more about Allah Azza wa Jal and more about His great religion. So he told him, you can't follow me. وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِدْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. How are you going to have patience over something they don't even have knowledge of? So Musa assured him and he said, قَالَ سَتَجِدُنِي إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهِ صَابِرًا وَلَا أَعْصِي لَكَ أَمْرًا. He said, inshaAllah, you will find me patient by the will of Allah, and I would never disobey you in anything that you order me in. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to stick to you. Whatever you tell me, I'm going to do. I'm not going to disobey you. And inshaAllah, you'll find me from those who will listen to you. So Khidr alayhi salam, he put the conditions. قَالَ فَإِنِ اتَّبَعْتَنِي فَلَا تَسْأَنِّي عَنْ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى أُحْدِثَ لَكَ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا. If you follow me, you want to be with me, you don't ask me about anything until I tell you. Okay? Don't ask until I tell you. Never ask me why this, why that, whether you like it or you don't like it. You follow me and don't ask until I tell you. So Musa alayhi salam, he said, yes, agreed. فانطلقا. And now the test begins. They went on their journey. حتى إذا ركبا في السفينة خرقها قال أخرقتها لتغرق أهلها لقد جئت شيئا إمرا. They wanted to go from one part of the sea to the other side. So they saw a small boat with poor, weak people working on the boat. So they told them in a nice way, can you please be generous to us to take us from this side to the other side? So those weak, poor people said, no problems, come on board. Ya Allah, inshallah, for the sake of Allah or for free, come. Maybe this is something that will get something good in the future. So Musa alayhi salam and the Khidr went on that boat. Allah is Yamul Khair. These people done a good favor to us. They were very nice and generous to us. At least if we can't benefit them in return, we shouldn't harm them. And this is the average person will do something like that. So what about a prophet? A prophet will try and even do more than that. He, Musa alayhi salam, is thinking, wallah, these people are very good people. They were so generous and kind to us to let us on board and take us from this side to the other side. He turns around. Where's the Khidr? He goes and looks for the Khidr. The Khidr is trying to break the boat. Subhanallah. We're just thinking about how good these people are, how generous they are, and you are breaking their boat. So he came up to me and said, what are you breaking up for? These people were good to us. Why are you doing such a crime like this? This is munkar, this is wrong. So Khidr looked at him and said, أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكَ إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَسْتَطِيعَ مَسَلًا. Didn't I tell you? Don't ask until I tell you. And didn't I tell you you're not going to have patience over what you see from me? So Musa said, forgive me, لَا تُؤَخِذْنِي. Excuse me. بِمَا نَسِيتُ وَلَا تُرْهِقْنِي مِنْ أَمْرِ عُسْرًا. Please excuse my forgetfulness. I forgot, and this is something I forgot, and you understand my position. Maybe I got so emotional because a prophet, ya ikhwani. You, as just simple Muslim, you would not even accept something like that to see. How about when you're a prophet or a messenger? A prophet and a messenger is very hard for them to see. But things just get hard and hard. فَانْتَلَقَى حَتَّى إِذَا لَقِيَ غُلَامًا. When they arrived to the other side of the sea, they were walking, they saw a group of kids playing. Al-Khidr, he saw one of the kids, he grabbed him on the side, فَقَتَلَهُ. He put him on the ground and he killed him. Allahu Akbar! Musa, a prophet, a messenger, is seeing a murder. Seeing such a crime happening in front of him. He was shocked. And who? What? A little kid? You slaughter and you kill a kid? موسى عليه السلام said, أقتلت نفسا زكية بغير نفس. You just killed an innocent life. How could you do something like this? This is haram. So the Khidr told him, what's going on here again? قال ألم أقل لك إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا. Didn't I tell you you're not going to have patience before? Didn't I tell you you're not going to have patience? And you assured me you're going to have patience? موسى again. قال please, sorry. I just got a bit more emotional this time. You understand where my situation is. This is a crime, but I'll stick to what you say, and I'll stick to what you do. And please, if I ever ask you, because Khidr got, he said, خلاص, go your way, finished. Musa said, look, please, if I ask you one more time, if I break the agreement again, that's when you tell me go. If I break the agreement again, you tell me go. قال إن سألتك عن شيء بعدها فلا تصاحبني قد بلغت من لدن عذرا. If I ever ask you again, you had reached your highest peak of accepting my excuses and you let me go. Everyone goes their way. فانطلقا. Again, they went. حتى إذا أتيا أهل قرية استطعما أهلها. They arrived to this town, tired, hungry, thirsty. And it was the custom of people that if there is someone who comes from outside, a guest, to give them, to be their host, to give them a good hospitality, to give them at least water, to give them a bit of food. And it's the custom of people to accept guests over and to be the host of guests for 3 days. They arrived to this town, the people of that town that were so wicked, so evil, so selfish, that they asked them for the smallest of hospitality. They refused. One by one, give us water, no. Food, get out of here. Bread, not interested. And while they were walking in the middle of the roads of that town, they saw a wall of a house falling down. Hey, you're just walking, minding your own business in one of the suburbs, and you see one fence falling down. How amazing would it be when you just come out of the car and you start fixing that fence for these people? Musa alayhi salam and Khidr are walking in the middle of the streets of this town. They saw this wall falling of this house. So Khidr stops out of nowhere. He starts to renovate that wall. Musa, of course, it's something amazing, but Musa doesn't dare to say something. And how is he going to say? He's already break the agreement twice, so he doesn't have the guts to say, or not the guts, Afwan, he doesn't have dare, or he's afraid to ask him again. So after, and Musa alayhi salam just following him, fixing the wall, and maybe at the back of his mind, what's going on here? What's out of all houses? This house? We don't even know who the people. We asked them for water, they refused to give us water. A cup of water they refused, a bread they refused, food they refused, and out of nowhere we're building a wall for them. After they renovated that wall, Musa told Khidr, he said, فَأَقَامَ قَالَ لَوْ شِئْتَ لَتَّخَذْتَ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا. He said, at least these people that refuse to give us water, these people that refuse to give us bread or food, maybe ask this person that we just built or renovated the wall, give us some money, payment in return, who could buy some water or food. So the Khidr looked at him and said, that's it. It's all over now. You promised me once, you broke it. Twice, you broke it. The third time, you told me, if you break this promise again and you're going to ask me for something before I tell you, everyone goes their way. قال هذا فراق بيني وبينك. That's it. This is the path for everyone now to go their separate ways. But before you go, so nothing at the back of your mind, you saw things, to you it's a big munkar, it's a big crime. Before you go, I want to teach you now. I want to teach you something that you probably don't know. Let me teach you, or let me explain to you and interpret to you the 3 incidents that we did in the past, so you know why we did it. And Musa is looking at this man, maybe he's a righteous servant, but the actions he did, they are criminals' actions. We just said the Khidr is a prophet, but these actions that he did are actions of criminals, not an action of a prophet. But if it's a God and interpretation, if there's an explanation from behind it, now you understand why he did it. He said, هذا فراق بيني وبينك. This is the separation point. Everyone goes their way,
But before you go, I want to explain things to you.
Number one, remember the boat that we broke it in return to the generosity and the kindness of the people that led us on. وَأَمَّا السَّفِينَةُ فَكَانَتْ لِمَسَاكِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ فِي الْبَحْرِ.
It belonged to masakeen, people in need. They were very poor people. And those poor people were generous
and kind enough to allow us to come on board and take us from one place to another.
And you saw me, in return, what did I do? I broke a part of it.
I was nearly going to make it sink in the ocean.
To you, you see that from your outside knowledge, you see that as a crime.
But if you know the reality of what I did, I done them the biggest favor.
If they knew about it, they'll pay him money for it.
He said, there was a king, a tyrant king, who was looking for every good ship around. And if he saw that ship with no fault in it, he would have took it. So I made that fault in that corner. So when the king sees that, he'll let that ship get away. And yes, after Musa and Khidr went on land, the king came and took all the ships except that ship. Why? Because it had that broken part that Khidr alayhi salam did. So what did Khidr do here? He done them a favor. He done them something good, not something bad. And that's where Khidr alayhi salam, he told Musa alayhi salam that how are you going to have patience over something that you don't even know of?
And then he said, and about the second incident, وَأَمَّا الْغُلَامِ, and about that kid that we slaughtered, you see it as murder. فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ فَخَسِينَ أَن يُرْهِقَهُمَا تُغْيَانًا وَكُفْرًا. From Allah's knowledge, this child is going to grow up. He was going to grow up to be an evil child. So corrupt, so evil. From his young age, he's doing funny things. And he's going to grow up. He is so evil, so wicked. And his parents are good people. And he's going to cause so much hardship. He's going to stress his parents.
So we wanted to replace his parents with a better child. And the story goes on. The moment that this kid was slaughtered and killed, Allah Azza wa Jalla made his mother fall pregnant. And Allah Azza wa Jalla gave him a righteous child.
فأردنا أن يبدلهما ربهما خيرا منه زكاة وأقرب رحمة.
We wanted Allah to exchange him with a better child, a child that's been granted rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and righteousness. And about that wall that you saw us renovate out of nowhere that was going to fall down. وأما الجدار فكان لغلامين يتيمين في المدينة.
That wall that belonged to that house belonged to two young orphans.
Masakin, yatama, orphans. Their father is dead, powerless, very poor. Their mother can't do much. So that house belonged to those two orphans, still young, can't protect and defend themselves. And under that wall, there was a big treasure hidden by their father. To them.
And you saw Musa with your own eyes. The people in that city and town are so wicked, so evil, that a cup of water wouldn't even give us.
So could you imagine if that wall falls down and they're still young, what would the people of that village would do? They'll take their treasure. So we renovated it enough and long enough for that wall to stay up until the kids grow up. When they grow up, they're strong enough that when the wall falls, they take their treasure and no one else. Why? Tabakai, this is something amazing.
Why these kids out of all kids and out of all orphans in the world, why those two?
I want you all to listen to this, my brothers and sisters. وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. Because their father was a righteous man.
Their father was a righteous man who feed Allah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla protected his children after him.
And that's why, my brothers and sisters, you want Allah to take care of your kids? Take care of Allah's deen.
You want Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect your kids?
Protect Allah's deen. And this is where Allah takes care of your kids.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent one of the greatest people, Al-Khidr and Musa, to these two young orphans, as to Allah protecting them because of their righteousness and the good doings of their own father.
وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا فَأَرَادَ رَبُّكَ يَبْلُغَ أَشُدَّهُمَا وَيَسْتَخْرِجَ كَنْزَهُمَا رَحْمَةً مِنْ رَبِّكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted them to grow up until they're strong and fit enough for them to take their treasure and no one else to take it from them.
And then he told him, before you go, all this that I just told you about, وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي. I did not do it from my own will. I did not do it from my own will. It was all from Allah. It's all what Allah had revealed to me. It's all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had ordered me to do. So it's nothing, something that I wanted to do. It's what Allah ordered me to do. وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ مَا لَمْ تَسْطَعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. This is the interpretation to those events that you could not even handle. This to tell you, my brothers and sisters, not everything you see, it's what echoes in your mind. Not everything that you see, it's what really it is in your mind. But sometimes you really need to see beyond what you really see. And sometimes you really need to have patience to see what Allah wants you to see. That's why Allah describes Al-Khidr, وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. This is the ilm, as the scholars say, ilm min ladun, a different knowledge. A knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a certain type of people. Ikhwani, the closer you are to Allah, the further Allah makes you see. The closer you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the further that Allah azza wa jal allows you to see. And that's why you see people are far away from Allah, they can't see too far. They just see a few meters in front of them, but they can't see beyond that. And they act upon that. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when you look at his actions were always just beyond what he used to see, just so far, because it's so close to Allah. Could you imagine when the Prophet ﷺ was leading his back to the Kaaba, while every companion was persecuted, tortured, and then he was asked, on messenger of Allah, ask Allah to give us victory. And Nabi ﷺ is talking about, in a moment, when Nabi ﷺ getting persecuted, tortured, him and his companions in Mecca, and Nabi's talking about opening Persia, opening Rome, east and west. You can't even take care of yourself. How are you going to take care of the east and the west? This is what people see at that time. But Nabi sees much more than that. Further than that. ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ مَا لَمْ تَسْطَعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. This is the interpretation where you don't see. Musa alayhi salam stayed suffering with Bani Israel until the last moment of his life. 2 years before his death, Harun alayhi salam passed away, his brother. And then 2 years later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the soul of Musa. There's some narrations that say, Bani Israel accused Musa for killing his brother. That's how stubborn they were. That's how arrogant they were. There's some narrations that say they accused Musa for killing his brother. And Musa kept on suffering a lot from Bani Israel. Until the moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to take his soul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always send the angel of death to take the permission of the prophet before taking his soul. This is to all prophets and messengers. Before the angel of death comes to take a soul of a prophet and a messenger, he takes his permission. And if he says take it, he'll take it. If he says no, he'll go back to Allah. So the angel of death was sent to take the soul of Musa alayhi salam. He asked him for the permission. Musa slapped him. And Musa was the hard type. Musa was strong, tough, and we said he pushed someone, he killed him. That hand was like a bulldozer. That's how he was, alayhi salam. He was strong in his character and he was strong in his physical body, strength. So, angel of death came to ask him for the permission. This is hadith in Bukhari. So, Musa, fasakkahu Musa, he slapped him, hit him. So, the angel of death went back to Allah and he said, oh Allah, you sent me to someone, a servant of yours that doesn't want to die. You sent me, أَرْسَلْتَنِي لَعَبْدٍ لَا يُرِيدُ الْمَوْتِ. You sent me to someone, a servant that doesn't want to die. So Allah Azza wa Jal told the angel of death, go back to Musa and tell Musa to put his hand on a bull. And for every hair his hand touches, I'll give him 1 year. You know how many hairs that? You're talking about thousands. You're talking about thousands of hairs. Tell Musa, and Allah alam, this is my hand. Allah alam how big his hands was. Allah alam how big his hands were. So Allah told him, tell Musa to put his hands on a bull. And for the number of hairs that his hands touch, I'll give him on you. So the angel of death went back to Musa alayhi salam, and he told him, Allah told you to put your hands on a bull. For each hair that your hands touch, Allah will give you a year. So Musa alayhi salam, he said, and then what? After that, then what? He said, then death, mort. Going back to death. So Musa said, oh Allah, now. What's the point? I'll get another 1,000 years. It's the same. This dunya is just the same. From hardship to hardships. From tough day to a more tougher day. This is life. So Musa alayhi salam said, then what? He said, then death. Allah responded or told him, then to death. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Musa said, Al-an, then Allah azza wa jal sent the angel of death to take his soul, and he took his soul. But before that, he said, Ya Allah, bury me, allow me to be buried one stone away from Bayt al-Maqdis. Because this is the place that Allah Azza wa Jalla promised Bani Israel. Ilya was named at that time, Bayt al-Maqdis, Jerusalem. This is the place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had promised Bani Israel. He said, Ya Allah, but take my soul where you throw one stone away from Bayt al-Maqdis, Jerusalem. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ba Allah, if I'm next to Bayt al-Maqdis, I'll show you where Musa is buried. So Musa alayhi salam is buried, maybe now in Jerusalem, because Jerusalem expanded. At that time he said, Ya Allah, throwing one stone away, bury me, I want to die there. And Musa alayhi salam is buried somewhere in Jerusalem. Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, By Allah, if I'm there, I'll show you his grave in the path where you see the red sand. Yani Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's like he's seen it fully. He sees the whole scene in front of him, عند الكثيب الأحمر, next to the red sand, I'll show it to you. And Musa alayhi salam passed away. For that, Yusha took over. Yusha alayhi salam lived 27 years after Musa alayhi salam. And Yusha alayhi salam, he took over the leadership of Bani Israel. At that time, it's a new generation. At that time, it's a new generation. This generation that Yusha alayhi salam was with, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, no one from the followers of Yusha were from the generation that bowed to the calf. You know that calf that Bani Israel started to worship? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took all the souls, so Yusha came with a new generation. It was better than the generation before, but not by a lot. And inshallah, we'll continue this story next week, bi'awnillah. Ikhwani, ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us firm and strong. Next week, inshallah, we'll finish with Yusha', Ilyas, Ilyasa', and we'll start with Dawood and Sulaiman, alayhim as-salam. May Allah Azza wa Jalla reward you all for listening. Subhanak Allah, bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu
ilayk. To listen to or download more Islamic lectures, please visit www.islamicmedia.com.au.